Really? A full house?
Shall we make a start?
What's the play tonight?
Yeah, death the Cubs ain't playing.
I think what keeps Chicago theater so fresh is that there's a constant renewing energy of young artists.
And the rest is history.
In Chicago, our creativity isn't stifled by economics. It's a raw energy here that's much different than anywhere else.
Many times as though I'm not the real life.
More Alice's inside. Enter our Alice's.
It's really a city that just allows you to focus on the work without all the outside pressure of fame and all that. People come here to do the work.
I see great things.
Oh, God, no running water in here.
The city and the community makes it vital. They go to the theater. They care. They want theater.
So what book are you reading?
What? Chicago actors, I think it's just they love to say the words. They don't like to hold them. They don't like to hoard them. And that's the biggest difference to me between a New York actor, for example, and a Chicago actor.
Yeah, pretty.
No way.
Fine. That's what you want to be about.
You want to be an actor in Chicago, you'll definitely work. You know, I mean, there's a lot of opportunity to work and do some really great theater.
You expect a something from me.
This is not parochial pride or hubris about, you know, Chicago's the greatest. It's a fact that Chicago has become a very important factor in theater, period.
All right, welcome. Welcome to this chapter of Alice in Wonderland.
In Chicago, theater can sneak up on you in the most unlikely settings. Like on Clark Street in the Andersonville neighborhood, where a seemingly timid woman in a bunny suit leads an audience in a surreal production of Alice in Wonderland.
Oh, Jesus Christ, what is that?
This isn't theater played out on a conventional stage. Instead, scenes are presented in alleys.
I lived here for 10 years. I had to move out, though. I can't afford it here anymore. But
in a neighborhood bar. In an art gallery. And on main streets and side streets in the area. More than a dozen artists and actors from a variety of theater companies participate in this gonzo street production of the Lewis Carroll classic. But its creator and star performer is Noel Krim, a member of the Dadaist theater group Neo Futurists.
I sort of started brainstorming with my husband. We thought of the Odyssey and stuff like that, which would have been a huge undertaking. But Alice seemed to lend itself better because there was already a built-in tour guide.
I think we need to head that way.
I was amazed because we don't have a lot to pay the artists, and so I thought that might be a difficult proposition, but everybody jumped on board.
This so-called environmental theater is nothing new here in Chicago. In 2000, star director Mary Zimmerman staged a peripatetic show for the Looking Glass Theater. The show, staged in a Ravenswood warehouse, was 11 rooms of Proust.
Yes, Swan used to come over.
There's something so enlivening about that when theater penetrates the real world and the real world theater. To see someone in a strange costume standing on a corner of Chicago, you know, downtown Chicago, it's spectacular and memorable, and you don't forget it.
Last night, trying to see all this as she does.
Only 40 years ago, locally produced theater in Chicago was almost non-existent. Now, more than 200 theaters are in the area, and critics from New York to London are calling Chicago's homegrown stage productions the most vital in the nation.
The profile of Chicago theater has never been better. I read this morning the latest story from Time Magazine's European edition, which says Chicago is the best theater in the country. The London Guardian said the same earlier this summer.
Live theater is also big business in Chicago. 2 years ago, more than 2 million people saw at least one live show in the area. And according to the League of Chicago Theaters, live theater here has more than doubled its impact on the region's economy in just 7 years. Most recent statistics from 2002 show that audiences spent $147 million on live theater in Chicago.
You'll find just about everyone at the theater in Chicago. It's not strictly a dress-up, plan-ahead, wait-for-Mother's-Day event.
What's the play tonight?
They're gonna tear it down. They're gonna tear the whole block down.
We ain't no second city to no New York that we give.
Welcome to Live Chicago Theater, now more influential than ever before.
Now I've got something to think about.
There's always been live theater in Chicago, but for decades, much of that theater came from out of town. Veteran critic Richard Christensen, whose new book, A Theater of Our Own, documents Chicago theater history, says the Windy City was the first stop after New York for touring companies.
Sarah Bernhardt played Chicago on all six of her American tours. She called Chicago the pulse of America, loved Chicago. There was a saying that if you didn't make money in New York, you could come to Chicago and make a little money because the audience was here. And all that started to change around the late 60s and early 70s when a group of very enterprising and pioneering young people came in.
There were a couple of groups which helped engineer this change. A young director named Bob Sickinger, imported from Philadelphia, was responsible for a series of influential productions at Hull House in the mid-60s.
Bob Sickinger was one of the wisest entrepreneurial director types that I have ever met. What he did was to collect a bunch of non-equity actors like me who he had heard about, and we did readings at the homes of very important, influential people. Most of them with a lot of money.
Steppenwolf sort of did, I think, carry on the style we had, which was a very physical theater, nitty-gritty kind of theater.
Then there was Second City, the first truly influential Chicago theatrical institution.
They started at the University of Chicago. Most of them were from the U of C. They started something called the Playwrights Theater Club in the mid-50s, which performed on the near north side. And they did classics and new plays as well.
In 1959, co-founder Paul Sills came up with the idea of opening a coffee house type establishment, featuring scripted and improvised skits.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to the Second City.
And they called it the Second City after the famous article by A.J. Liebling in the New Yorker, which made fun of Chicago as the Second City, and were an immediate, whopping success. But the reviews were topical, they were witty, and they were performed by very, very talented people. Ellen Arkin, Eugene Krupnik, Barbara Harris, Severn Darden, Mina Cole. Those were members of the very early companies.
Key to the success of Second City were the teachings of Sills' mother, Viola Spolin. She came up with the improvisational techniques still used at the theater today.
It's just playing games and following the rules. That's all it is. Apparently, 5-year-olds can do this really well. But grown-ups sort of forget how. The whole notion of improvisation is yes and. Yes, I'll take what you give me and I'll build on that and we'll create something.
My husband, Bern, and I were in Playwrights Theater with Paul Sills. I think Paul and his mother, because she created the games, really fueled and changed American comedy all over the country. Everything you see on television, even the sitcoms, come from that notion.
Countless comedic talents, from John Belushi to Bill Murray to Chris Farley to Mike Myers, came from Second City. And the theater has branches now in Toronto, Los Angeles, and Las Vegas.
I got my MBA from Florida State University. How about you?
I was a Kappa!
So we have people going to Saturday Night Live all the time. And also to Mad TV. We have a whole group at Mad TV.
I meant hit the road.
Hit the road?
Hit the road, Jack.
In the last 15 years, we have a training center now that has over 1,500 students, I think, in Chicago alone. Everybody that's gone through the training center ultimately, ends up on, one of our either our touring companies or our main stages.
Second City touring companies have traveled to almost 20 other countries. This one is off to the Mideast for a winter tour.
Waiter?
Is there a problem, sir?
We just need bread.
Second City sketches are scripted, but improvisation figures heavily in the scripting process.
We rehearse during the day, and we'll bring in a premise. So I'll have a premise for both of us, and it's that I'm trying to sell carpet, but you're allergic to carpet, but I have to sell this carpet or something. So we give that scene a try, and we improvise it in rehearsal. And then we get to try it in the set after the show, the improv set. So we use those improv sets during our previews to test material. And if the audience doesn't respond, then God bless, it goes on its way. And if it goes well, then we try to script it, and then we'll just keep honing it. We'll keep trying it in the sets, and then maybe it will go into the running room.
Maybe today the scenery is a little more elaborate, but it's basically the same. Usually anywhere seven people, four men, three women sometimes. Basic props and scenery, and a piano off to one side providing musical accompaniment. And then the crowd clustered in tables around the stage. Very, very basic, but very hip.
See, Gerhard, I told you could play Bach in a nightclub and people will listen. Yeah?
Times were changing in the late 60s, and Chicago theater began to reflect that change. Partially due to the influence of Bob Sickinger's Hull House group, many young actors opened storefront theaters in the city.
Stuart Gordon's Organic Theater was started in 1970 in Chicago. The Kingston Mines Theater, Chicago City Players, The Body Politic, all of which started in the late 60s and early 70s, were all a part of that youth culture of the time.
I actually really started at the Wisdom Bridge Theater on Howard Street, but my first job directing was for the Apollo Theater, then housed at the St. Nicholas Theater. I did work for about a year and a half at the St. Nicholas Theater. I worked with David Mamet and Stephen Schachter and William H. Macy, who were all the leaders of the St. Nicholas at that time. It was a really competitive time in the best sense, that everybody wanted to do their best work and everybody felt they were the best.
Summer loving had me a blast.
Summer loving happened so fast.
One well-known production which came from this creative cauldron was Grease, originally produced by Chicago theater legend June Pekosik at the Kingston Mines Theater.
Jim Jacobs and Warren Casey were in my company. And after rehearsals, you know, we would have parties. Warren would sing songs he was writing. And they were like 60s takeoffs, and they were very funny. And they were talking about like making it into a play. And I said, why don't you write it and we'll do it in the fall?
If you're filled with affection, you're too shy.
I knew it was going to be a success immediately. Play was so different than it is, the play that it turned out to be on Broadway. It was quite different. There was a lot more story, and it was a lot tougher.
By the mid-1970s, Stuart Gordon's Organic Theater had reached its peak, producing actors such as Dennis Franz, Joe Mantegna, and Meshach Taylor, and shows like Warp and ER.
In there. If that wind wasn't blowing in there, I'd have been out of here. Been a home run, sure thing.
Sure thing, huh?
Yeah, I was sure of it.
Their masterpiece, according to critics such as Richard Christensen, was 1977's Bleacher Bums.
Stewart was very much into improvisation. Bleacher Bums was, in part, an improvised show. I mean, they went out to Wrigley Field and saw what the people were like, and then they came back and based their play on the characters they had seen in the right field section of the bleachers at Wrigley Field, and created this marvelous, marvelous comedy in nine innings, they called it.
Organic also produced the first major work of Chicago's quintessential playwright, David Mamet. 1974's Sexual Perversity in Chicago was later adapted by Second City's Tim Kazurinsky into the hit 1986 film About Last Night.
What's for breakfast?
Egg McMuffin, corner of Broadway and Belmont.
When the movie was finally made in 1986, 7 years and 14 full drafts of screenplays after we'd started, none of the three networks would carry advertising with the title Sexual Perversity in Chicago. That was just way too risque. Mamet is brilliant. The best writer of dialogue in the last 50 years.
Over the past years, I've sold him, I can't tell you the dollar amount, but quite a lot of land. I promised him 5 weeks ago I'd go to the wife's birthday party in Kenilworth tonight.
Mamet's Glengarry Glen Ross and American Buffalo, originally produced on local stages like the St. Nicholas and the Goodman Theaters, are now considered American classics.
It's very, very heightened realism. The language is not particularly how we speak in the street. It's how we speak in the street times 10. It's so much fun to act in a Mamet play. It's really just a joy. And I also think it's just a joy to watch. You never get bored in a Mamet play.
The monthly interview.
Oh, for the magazine.
Yes. Is this something I can talk about?
I wanted to speak with you about
that. Oh, we'll do that this weekend.
My wife told me to look into it.
Beautiful.
You have to remember that if you're doing it with David in the house, he's always saying, don't act, just say the words. I find it very natural. It's not the way I speak normally, but it comes easily to me. I can memorize it quickly, and I'm trying to be very accurate.
By the early 1980s, theaters like the St. Nicholas and the Body Politic were all disappearing. But they had set the tone for new Chicago theaters which would have national and international success.
For very little money, you developed good actors, good storytelling techniques. And I think that's the thing, was to get the audience's attention through good storytelling and good acting. And if you could sort of master those two things, tell a good story, get good actors, then you could make theater happen. It didn't matter if you had $50 or $5,000 or $50,000 or $500,000. And I think the same principle still applies.
You guys together could absolutely lick the civilized world.
Without some smart cookie getting up ahead.
I'll see y'all a bit more. Happy if we could work that out.
By 1975, there was a new player in town. Highland Park residents Gary Sinise and Jeff Perry joined up with Illinois State University actor Terry Kinney to form the Steppenwolf Theater Company. They were later joined by young, ambitious actors like John Malkovich, John Mahoney, Laurie Metcalf, and Joan Allen.
They were in your face all the time and most exciting. And they did a lot of intense off-Broadway dramas at that time. They became so well known in their little place in Highland Park that eventually they moved down to Chicago.
We were going day to day and month to month in the early days of Steppenwolf. We were basically just trying to build something and do our acting.
Sinise, now a celebrated TV and film actor, played in rock and roll bands as a teenager. He still plays with a rock band today, Lieutenant Dan's Band, named after his character in Forrest Gump. Some say this rock music foundation influenced Steppenwolf's energetic acting style.
It was the local critics here that kind of dubbed us the rock and roll theater company. We had a lot of energy, that's for sure. We were a very aggressive theater company and always wanted to do plays that, you know, really challenged us, and we're very physical and that kind of thing. And then we did plays that had a lot of rock music in them.
Now, this is my dinner, understand?
No, I invited you.
Uh-uh. You had all the expenses.
And when the company expanded, when they moved to Chicago, they wanted to double the size of it, so everybody was invited, all the members were invited to ask somebody in. And I was the one that John Malkovich asked in. John was very competitive, but he was never selfish in any way. I'd go to make an entrance, and he'd all of a sudden, in front of my face, he'd go, don't screw up. And it was just fun. We never took ourselves, you know, super seriously or anything like that.
By the 1980s, a series of celebrated productions had New York taking notice of the Chicago group.
The great Steppenwolf show for me has always been Baum and Gilead, which was done in 1980. It was a Lanford Wilson play set in a greasy spoon all-night diner in the lower edge of New York. It used about 30 people, and it was such a vivid recreation of naturalistic, poetic drama at the same time.
You know, Joe said you came to New York to be a teacher.
I remember we collected something like 8 or 9 Joseph Jefferson Awards for that. The most highly honored show, and we were taking home our $75 a week, you know, before taxes.
When they moved, Balm and Gilead, Anna Nightingale sang True West with John Malkovich and Gary Sinise, and Orphans with John Mahoney and Terry and Kevin Anderson. They just took New York critics by storm.
Despite rumors of moving to New York in the 1980s, Steppenwolf has remained in Chicago.
All right, sister, make up your mind. You gonna have champagne with him or not?
We won the Tony Award and for regional theater. We came onto the national scene, and we went from a local Chicago company to a nationally recognized company. So I think what we had to prove here to our board and to our audience was that no matter how much attention we were getting on the national scene and in New York, we were still a Chicago-based theater company.
People paying good money to see you, and you say impossible. Very nice indeed, I don't think.
I don't want to be seen.
Difficult when you're playing King Lear with the lighting you use.
I don't want to see.
Now they've become a cultural institution in the city, maintaining its founding ensemble members and adding new talent like Chicago theater veterans Amy Morton and the actor and playwright Tracy Letts.
I was with a company before Steppenwolf called Remains Theater for about 15 years. And so we kind of grew up together, Remains and Steppenwolf. They were who I aspired to be, absolutely, from the moment I saw their first play when I was 18. Certainly I was intimidated by their talent because, you know, everybody wants to be Laurie Metcalf.
Last note, sir, before my time.
I'm not from Chicago. I'm from Oklahoma originally. And a lot of actors came to the city who were interested in working in the theater. And Steppenwolf is one of the reasons why. I mean, they're sort of legendary for their ability to consistently put good work on stage. And it's just a marvelous success story, you know, from a church basement in Highland Park to where they are now 30 years later.
Malkovich became a major film and stage star. Joan Allen, you know, John Mahoney, they all were able to catapult into fame from those productions. So it was the Steppenwolf productions that really stamped Chicago as a big theater town.
If only I could come up with a good, catchy title.
You don't sing to feel better. You sing because that's the way of understanding life.
Some of us take our work seriously. My work is keeping Oceania
sick. It's too big to go in there. What shall I do?
Chicago's stages are internationally known for their acting talent, but it is also a city where powerful directors reside. Many of the city's best directors are at the Goodman Theater.
He was a playwright himself, Kenneth Sawyer Goodman, a scion of a family who had made a lot of money in the lumber industry. Goodman died of influenza in 1917. He was 35, and his parents, as a kind of memorial to him, proposed to the Art Institute that they establish a theater. And they built the Goodman Theater in 1925. The Goodman was one of the most important of the resident theaters in the United States by the 80s and 90s. And so it was imperative for these major playwrights to be represented on its stage.
Robert Falls has been the artistic director of the Goodman since 1986, after a celebrated run at the old Wisdom Bridge Theater on Howard Street, where he directed masterpieces like In the Belly of the Beast, starring William L. Peterson.
I was ready for a larger theater, a larger venue, so I kind of embraced it. Kind of fearlessly, maybe recklessly, sort of had no trouble jumping into the Goodman and working on a large stage.
Displays in the Royal Palms, all the hotels, and banners over the ring and the basketball court. Lohman Brothers. Baby, we could sell sporting.
That is a $1 million idea.
Marvelous.
I'm in great shape.
Falls' greatest work at the Goodman arguably was his revival of Arthur Miller's Death of a Salesman in 1999.
The fact that we did it at the Goodman with no expectations, and the fact that it was so successful that it ended up going to Broadway, and then was so successful on Broadway, It's probably the only play I've ever done which was just like a blessed play from beginning to end. So many people were moved by it, and that was very moving to me because I was so moved by the play.
Life isn't real to movie people, not like it is to you.
Well, all I want is just to get this picture finished, preferably without stepping on too many toes.
The Good Men most recently featured the world premiere of Miller's Finishing the Picture, a look at the making of The Misfits, the final film of the playwright's ex-wife, Marilyn Monroe.
The city say they're gonna build some houses.
Other notable writers like August Wilson and Rebecca Gilman also appreciate this theater.
I've always said that we try to do classic plays with the energy and excitement as if it was written yesterday, and to try to do a classic, you know, a new play with the reverence that one might give to one of the old masters.
I got style.
Everybody got style. Style ain't nothing but keeping the same idea from beginning to end.
Directors like Chuck Smith, Henry Godinez, and Mary Zimmerman have contributed to notable Goodman plays in the last decade.
You go to make it artistically right here at the Goodman. You know, you're not worried about, we got to get a star to draw a crowd. No, we don't care about that. We got to just do a really good show.
The Goodman has a kind of staff and facility and funding that makes it very smooth for me to put up something. You know what I'm saying? That there's just a facility there, a lot of experience, 80 years of experience of producing.
Zimmerman, whose The Notebooks of Leonardo da Vinci and Galileo Galilei were produced at the Goodman, is best known for her affiliation with the Looking Glass Theater.
They live forever. They never die.
What is it, some verb they have?
Most notably, her unique interpretation of Ovid's Metamorphosis originated at the Looking Glass in 1998. That show was a huge success in New York and earned Zimmerman the 2002 Tony Award for Best Director.
And now it's been done in Peru, Australia, it's being translated to Chinese, India, it's done a production. These are all small productions. To me, these old stories have proved their relevance by the fact that they're still alive. If they weren't relevant, if they weren't immediate and vivid and had things to say that are fundamental to being a human being, they would have expired and be dead.
The Looking Glass Troupe, organized in 1988 by a group of Northwestern University theater students, has specialized in innovatively staged work.
But the first thing I saw them do, was a production adaptation of the Upton Sinclair novel, The Jungle, about the squalid and terrible lives of immigrants in the meatpacking industry in Chicago, directed by David Schwimmer. Surprised me for the ease and maturity with which Schwimmer staged this very, very complex production.
I'm more fearful of whites than blacks.
I'm going to tell you how the whole thing started with the Jews.
Where are we?
This is the first time in my life that I'm really mad this way.
When I really want to fight him, you know what I do?
I have a hard time understanding what he's into. Are we
getting Schwimmer into also directed a highly acclaimed interpretation of Studs Terkel's Race in 2003.
We'd come up with an adaptation, and we'd table it, we'd read it, and then we'd go back and work with the actors and generate stories from their own lives. We're also, as far as I know, one of the few companies that has lasted this long with a completely democratic process, which the majority vote really wins.
The Looking Glass now has a home in the Chicago Waterworks Pumping Station on Michigan Avenue.
I think it is a fairly unique little niche that we've carved, and I guess primarily because what we do is usually the creation of an original work.
If your purse be fat, you shall not lack for wine, nor whiskey, nor bread, nor sack.
Another theater in a high-profile area is the Chicago Shakespeare Theater on Navy Pier, started by veteran Chicago actress Barbara Gaines in 1986.
In 1986 in the summer, we went to the Red Lion Pub, and we did our first production of Henry V. There it was, the Battle of Agincourt, surrounded by this, you know, all this British beer, hamburgers, the smell of French fries. They wanted a theater on Navy Pier when they started revamping it and redoing it. It took enormous amount of cooperation between city, state, donors.
Bear mine to him, and so depart.
Michael Billington, who is the esteemed critic from The Guardian in London. came here and saw a production of King John. And part of the review, he really loved the production, but part of it was, I could not believe it, he said. He said, King John, that is a detested play in England, runs 10 weeks at Chicago Shakespeare, and in the audience were teenagers, were older people, were blue-collar workers, and people from obviously from the suburbs. He said the mix and diversity in the house was astounding.
For England, cousin, go!
Go in natural was supposed to set us free, but I spent as much time braiding, blowing out, and afro picking as I ever did trying to keep a perm together.
You all look so serious.
Staging work by new playwrights has always been a hallmark of Chicago theater. One of the theaters best known for developing new work is the Victory Gardens, which was started by 8 Chicago theater artists back in 1976. Dennis Zacek took over as the theater's artistic director in 1977, a job he still holds today.
I was looking for diversity. I didn't just want to have a bunch of middle-aged white guys writing plays.
Who's he having an affair with?
Everyone! The ensemble features 3 people of color, 3 women, and even though I didn't realize it at the moment, 3 writers who are either gay or lesbian.
This is a great day for Chicago. And a great day for the Chicago theater community, which has done so much to support our mission.
Like the Steppenwolf and Goodman, Victory Gardens has received a Tony Award for regional theater.
All around the U of C,
we quit splitting the atom. Don't you know we all got an issue that ready tap tap?
Our subscription base is highest it's ever been, but we have purchased the Biograph Theater, which is about 2 blocks away. So we'll be maintaining 6 theaters. We have now taken on the title of Victory Gardens and American Center for New Plays.
I've never seen a show or listened to his audio tapes or read anything beyond the jacket of one of his books, but I'm of the considered opinion that he's a charlatan and a huckster, and if there weren't any such thing as Oprah or television, he'd be peddling snake oil from the tailgate of Horse Dung.
At Chicago Dramatists, on the city's near northwest side, the playwright is also king.
When Gary says, you didn't, did you?
Organized in 1979, this theater has developed more than 400 new works.
2 years ago, we managed to get the 4 largest theaters that would do new work here in town, the Goodman, Steppenwolf, Northlight, and Victory Gardens. Playwrights can't just stay home and write a play. They need actors, they need directors, they need audiences, really.
I'm giving you a count of 3 to show you stuff.
One such new work at Chicago Dramatists is The Age of Cynicism, a musical featuring improvisation and audience interaction.
There's an element of randomness and a little audience participation. So it's a little improv mixed with a scripted play. It's exciting to work with writers at all levels, and you know, some that have been through playwriting programs and others who maybe just started writing because they're an actor.
Relationship only to help me weave my terrible tangled web.
I think I lean more towards contemporary plays. I'm really not too interested in pulling Dustin off Shakespeare. I'm really interested in new voices.
Then there's the Black Ensemble Theater, founded in 1976 by local actress Jackie Taylor. This popular group has staged a series of original musicals based on African-American music. Most recently, the ensemble has staged a gospel show called Somebody Say Amen, Great Women of Gospel.
Well, you took it to another level, and no one has matched her since.
When you are a theater company that wants to cross bridges, that wants to reach out to a diverse community, then why not use those tools that already do that?
What happened to you?
music already crosses bridges. Also, music sells. I mean, theater is a business. You gotta make money.
Now with Black Ensemble Theater, the ETA Theater, and the Latino Theater Festival, live drama is reaching a diverse audience.
Chicago's got 7 black theater companies producing full seasons. There's no other city in this country that has that much activity. It's a very healthy environment.
Chicago has seen its share of legendary theaters die. Actors and audiences still lament the death of Remains Theater, a company which launched the careers of actors Amy Morton, Gary Cole, and William L. Peterson, and lasted for almost 20 years, finally reaching the end of the line in 1995.
I missed Remains a lot. It had a particular niche in this town that I don't think has been filled since its demise. So, you know, I have very fond memories of that.
To establish a true relationship with God, one must renounce all things earthly and mundane.
Yes!
But for every Remains Theater that dies, there seems to be another taking its place. Non-equity or non-union locations continue to thrive here. The Timeline Theater, operating on the second floor of a church on Wellington Avenue, is one such venue.
It's always been our mission since we started the company in 1997 to do plays that somehow explore history and bring new facets of history to life on stage. And really the plays that we're most drawn to, you know, there certainly are a lot of great historical stories out there, but the ones we're most drawn to are ones that seem to connect and resonate today.
Timeline has staged a number of critically praised efforts, most notably Hannah and Martin, about the romance between Jewish philosopher Hannah Arendt and her mentor, lover, and Nazi sympathizer, Martin Heidegger. Elizabeth Rich and David Parks are the stars.
Because of the nature of this piece and the way that these people are kind of wrestling with these ideas, and the way the audience is kind of coming at this thing, unlike anything I've done before, there's this real sense of an event.
Martin, I have to take you into the living room and talk with you.
According to Actors Equity, salaries for union actors average around $500, while non-union actors make about half that. But Rich and Parks, both non-equity actors, say their non-union status gives them a certain amount of freedom.
I would hate to think that going equity would mean you could never work. I mean, this is one of my favorite spaces ever in this city, and the famous door space, which I think was the Steppenwolf space, the old Hull House.
Right, sure.
Also one of my favorite spaces to see, and I loved working there, and I loved watching theater there.
And you're cool.
The Neo-Futurist Theater Group is also non-equity. This unique troupe has the longest-running play in the city, Too Much Light Makes the Baby Go Blind, which began its long run way back in 1988.
14, that is called blatant sexual exploitation.
In this play, writer-actors perform 30 original plays in 60 minutes.
In Chicago, I don't think I would prefer to be equity. I don't think there are enough opportunities. And I think the opportunities that are there are a lot more standard fare. I don't think there are a lot of equity jobs for writers who want to do avant-garde theater.
I think looking for neo-futurists who write, direct, and perform their own work, it makes sense to remain non-equity because usually if you're equity, you've moved into a specific direction. You are an actor, you are a director, you are a playwright. So since we're looking for people who can do it all, and generally young people, I think it just makes sense that we're a non-equity company.
A very short negative play, go!
No.
The bottom line is that in Chicago, equity and non-equity actors coexist peacefully and often perform together.
Chicago is real unusual in that it, unlike any other city, I think, in the nation, it has a large non-union theater scene that is very active, very reputable, very respected and embraced and loved by the public. And I don't think that's true in other cities.
Theaters now in the Chicago area, the future seems bright. But dozens of theaters have closed here in the past decade, and dozens more will surely close in the upcoming years. What saves many Chicago theaters is their nonprofit status. 57% of Chicago theater companies are not-for-profit, giving them tax-exempt status and the ability to accept charitable contributions.
Generally, for a nonprofit theater, 60% of your budget will come from what they call earned income, which would be ticket sales, if you sell t-shirts or something, that's in there. If you teach classes, things you get paid for. And 40% would be contributed by donors.
Thank God the city has been so great to us. You know, we couldn't be in this beautiful space without the city of Chicago renting it to us basically for $1 a year. It's not enough just to build a subscription base. You know, we have our loyal followers and supporters, but it's not enough. That's really a lot of what, you know, we spend our time doing too, is going to companies like SBC, where we're going later today, and saying, you've been great supporters of ours, we still need your support, you know, can you pledge for X amount for the next 2 years?
Recent statistics from the League of Chicago Theaters show that local theaters create an estimated 6,400 full or part-time jobs, including 1,400 acting jobs.
Oh, I have a family, and you know, my family's here. I'm really grounded here. My roots are here, you know, and I love my city, and I love working here. So I could definitely see myself here for a few more years. I mean, the coast, they'll always be there, you know, if I choose to go out there. But Chicago's always going to be home for me.
I think we're definitely in the middle of a golden era now. I have a home in Oak Park, and my home is Chicago, and. I have no intention of getting in front of a camera again, not for a long time.
Among the more promising younger artists in Chicago theater are playwrights Brett Neveu, Rebecca Gilman, and Tracy Letts.
They're not culturally sensitive, if you know what I mean.
I guess I don't.
Gilman's internationally acclaimed Spinning into Butter was first performed at the Goodman in 1999.
It's black or white or red, racially divided.
You know what I think it is. Ever since Devaney left,
what did Nancy tell you?
She says you maybe you're confused.
While Letts's Man from Nebraska first performed at the Steppenwolf was a Pulitzer Prize finalist for drama in 2004.
One of the great things about Chicago theater is that if you write a new play, you can get it done. Maybe it's in a 40-seat house, maybe it's in a big space, but your plays will always get done here.
You could swim in circles. And
there's a certain safety here that allows the playwright, and I think it's because of in New York or London even Los Angeles, there's such a focus on the business. Here, people just kind of go about their lives, and theater is not huge. That sort of gives the playwright the feeling that, well, I can try anything.
And go around and give and take between the groups. And Alan's group, let me hear you, and go.
There is no equality.
But to really experience the future of Chicago theater, you have to head to Evanston, to the Piven Theater. For 30 years, the theater has run a learning center and workshop where students ranging from fourth graders to adults have studied acting. John Cusack, Aiden Quinn, and co-founder Joyce Piven's son Jeremy learned their craft here in the past. These days, local high schoolers are being taught improvisational techniques under the tutelage of Piven Theater Associate Director Jennifer Green.
Give and take, it's a game, but it's also a principle. It's focusing on that most basic building block of communication, listening and receiving. When do we take the space and share our voice? When do we suspend our speech?
The focus is not on self. How am I doing? You know, am I doing it right? How do I look? Me. A lot of trust is built up because over the years, if a child stays in the work, what they have is a creative community.
These students could be part of a future golden age in Chicago theater. But observers say they'll be hard-pressed to rival the theater scene going on today in the city.
Because it's pervasive in American theater and international theater. I mean, this is essential to know about.
You know,